Me. Children. I think perhaps I didn't want to have kids. Not really. Though I loved those we got. I think I did. I have memories of doing so, at least. I remember driving them to nursery on their first day, and my feelings of pride. I drove slowly through our neighborhood, through town. I wanted it to be noticed that I had children, and that my children were secured in the back seat in accordance to the law. What? I remember soft hands clinging about my neck, and that it meant something to me.
White within white.
The sound of sleeping children.
Within white, white within white.
I don't remember why I left Andreas yesterday. I know we had a disagreement, that I got angry, that I tried to hit him but missed, that I took his jacket as he put up the tent, that I turned and ran. But I've no idea why. All I know is that I thought, what you're doing to me now is enough for me to leave you here, and for me to leave my kids, my mum, my friends.
Get up, walk.
Perhaps I was already beginning to get cold. I don't know. But this morning, Andreas, I turned back. Turned and headed back towards you, the way I think I'd come. But I could see no tracks. Any trace of me was gone. So I sat down.
When the body's core temperature drops below 32 degrees,
and now I no longer see anything.
Tremors increase in
I must keep my eyes shut. I can't put my jacket on. My hands are frozen.
Difficulties with speech and thought begin. Memory loss may occur. Difficulties with walking. Signs of depression. And a desire to withdraw become evident in the patient.
Sing a song then. To the pathophysiological freezing of tissue, to the ice crystals that have started forming in my hands, where the temperature has dropped to 5 degrees, to the sharp-edged crystals that tear at the cells as I rub my hands to warm them, and sing to the salt that destroys the tissue and cell membranes as the ice melts, and the rime which serves to remind me of which are the most vulnerable areas. Ears, nose, fingers and toes. Ears, nose, fingers and toes. But you must choose. You can't have everything. You can keep your feet or your fingers, not both. You must be moderate in your demands. With feet, I can leave this place. Not that I know where to go. I've no desire to go anywhere. In fact, I'm quite happy here. The sun is shining again today. I feel the light against my eyelids. Warm. I sit on my legs and they are warm. Nothing else is warm, but they are at least. They can walk wherever they please. To Andreas, or on to Disco Bay, or dance in the snow around me as my mouth sings the song to frostbite. Because everything is white. If you look long enough. If you start to walk. Shall I tell you about the Greenland ice? No? Something else? Shall I tell you that safety doesn't exist? That everyone discovers, sooner or later, that reality is all there is? Shall I tell you that I discovered this way too late, on the day my friend got her driving license, and we nearly had a head-on collision with a lorry on a wet road one night, on the way from one town to the next? That she swerved the car, so we ended up in a ditch on our heads and were pulled out into the rain through the smashed windows. Because there is no such thing as safety, just an eternal attempt to create it. And you read up on things. You think that as long as you're prepared, if you take every eventuality into account, nothing can harm you. And you do your research. Sign up to various groups. Read up on avalanche victims in the Easter snow. You teach yourself how to escape from a sinking car by equalizing the pressure. You learn how to give first aid, how to cut yourself out of a burning car, how to secure the site of an accident, how to get the heart pumping again, how to splint a broken limb, that you must run zigzag if you're under fire. But most amateur gunmen have trouble hitting a moving target at more than 20 meters, and you pull out all the plugs before bedtime and sleep with the emergency fire ladder extended and the window ajar, and you know the hazards of the cold from all those courses you both attended when you bought the mountain cabin, and you know what you did when you took your husband's jacket and left him. You know he's been there for over 24 hours. You know it's minus 26 degrees centigrade out here. You know that practically no one survives that long. You know he never realized he was about to freeze to death. That he just started to shiver. That he probably started to run after you, following your tracks in the snow. That he started to sweat, which only made things worse. You know that he became confused and lost his fine motor skills as his core temperature dropped to 34 degrees. You know that his voice became slurred. The tremors worsened. He became irrational and took off his clothes. That he felt warmer and warmer, lethargic, and that his body stopped shaking as it approached 30 degrees. That the glucose stopped burning in his muscles because there wasn't enough to keep his core temperature up. That he began to feel pleasantly tired and happy, euphoric. That he thought he'd run after you as soon as he'd had a few minutes' rest. You know that the man you once met on a mountain lay down in the snow and that his body instinctively curled up into a fetal position. You know that the body of the man you were once head over heels in love with is growing stiff as the CO2 builds up in his muscles. that behind his eyelids, the pupils of the man you married, slept with, and had children with, are dilating. You know his body is trying to go into hibernation as his temperature drops to 31 degrees, that the blood flow to his outer extremities is stopping as his body concentrates on his heart, brain, and lungs, that his heart and respiratory system are shutting down. But the person you abandoned, for reasons you've forgotten, and whom you've both loved and hated, has turned into a metabolic freezer, and that his heart has long since stopped. You know he'd already forgotten you several years ago. You know that if you're to survive, you must now walk.
Get up, walk.
Because you are freezing to death.
Get up, walk now. Get up, walk.
Get up and walk.
Get up, walk now.
Look at the compass
now.
On your watch.
Get up, walk now. Get up, walk. Walk now.
But I don't. I'm going nowhere. Where would I go? Across a white land, into the white, and further into the white within white. To Disco Bay, but without music from the Nanook Hotel Bar. Just 7,000 tons of ice and ice cubes transported to Tokyo and drunk by me at a bar in Roppongi 6 years ago. You will remember me. I promise you that. Do you remember me now, Andreas? Do you see me now? I promise you will remember me. You can be fucking sure. Do you recall that story I heard in Helsinki when I was there with my faculty about the old woman who wanted to take the elevator up to the top floor of the bank one Friday just before closing time? The elevator stopped midway between the top floors, the lights went out, and then everything went totally silent. But she didn't press the alarm, didn't shout for help. Instead, she sat on the floor in the dark. And as her eyes grew accustomed to the space, black turned to white, dark white in the black. And she sat like that, resigned, all weekend, without opening her mouth, without hammering on the doors or screaming for help. She sat there until Monday, until the lights came on in the elevator and it started to move, until she noticed that the elevator was descending. And she got up, confused and exhausted, walked out onto the ground floor and took the tram home. Do you remember me telling you about it? Had you forgotten? What I didn't tell you was that there was no old woman in the elevator. Nobody told me that story. I didn't speak to anyone in Helsinki. It was me who sat in that elevator. I never told you that. I never told you. I kept that story to myself, along with all the others I collected over time, along with the stories in the books that I read, that I studied and lectured on, the books that were always on the coffee table, on the kitchen worktop, books I left out, so you'd have to tidy them away, and in so doing, might perhaps ask me, what's this you're reading? What's this one about? By the way, if you plan to be out long, Andreas, you should put on a sweater. Yes, it's very cold now. Have you noticed? Maybe we should go to Tenerife next year. Truth is, I've always been happiest in the sun. White, and then white within the white. 7,000 tons of ice in the sea, enough to keep all the world's drinks cold until tomorrow.